when we're across from the border, we always put up a window, just sit there and be quiet, don't say anything. But I appreciate her, but I'm ready to get home and see my little old English bulldog. I miss her. We kind of got a bad report of what the person was watching her today and found out that she put her in her kennel and left her all night long and went somewhere. We weren't too impressed by that, but we had good neighbors who let us know and have watched out for her. And so I love my dog. It's a little weird relationship, I guess, with my dog. My wife always says, "I hate that dog," and then I'll say, "Let's get rid of it." She says, "No, we can't get rid of our dog." She says the same thing about me. I said, "Well, get rid of me." "No, you can't get rid of me." No, she never tells me she hates me. And I want to clarify, my wife does not wake up ugly every day. People keep saying that, "I don't know how you're living. I don't know how you're surviving." She wakes up beautiful, but sometimes she wakes up cranky, but not every day. Not even half the time. Maybe 33%. Somebody said, "Don't talk them away, you know, preach the word." That's probably where we should go. Probably what we should get into is the word of God. But I feel like God wants to do something tonight.
Yeah.
I feel like God wants to pour out his spirit. But it's only, I feel like it's here tonight. I believe with all my heart. Hallelujah. For anybody in the house, I don't want to embarrass you. I don't want to make you look silly or anything like that. We're the family of God. But is there anybody tonight that says, I don't want the Holy Ghost? If you want a refilling of the Holy Ghost, that's good too. But I want by faith for you to raise up your hand and say, "God, I want you to fill me tonight. I'm by faith, a sign of faith. God, I want you to renew me tonight. God, I want you to help me tonight." In the name of Jesus, we're going to pray and just ask that God would help us. God, we love you today, and we thank you for your word that we've heard this week. God, we thank you for those that have entered into your spirit, God, those that have pressed on a little further than what might be normal, God, or what might be comfortable. But I pray in the name of Jesus for the next few minutes, God, that you would just bless, and a manifestation, God, of your spirit would come into this place, God. Do a work. In the name of Jesus, we pray. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. I want to talk to you on this title. Some of you might have heard the story. You're going to know where I'm going. But one thing I realize about young people is you can preach the same message 10 times and they never heard it. Because halfway through, they zone out and get on Facebook. So you switch it up and all of that stuff. But it sounds funny, but really, it's not funny. My little girl, we try our best. She loves her iPad, but I hope she's not on it right now because that made me look bad. But we don't allow her to bring it to church and sit on church and watch her iPad. She's 4 years old. But we're going to train her that when we go to church, it's all about giving God attention, not playing on devices and that kind of stuff. But I want to talk to you on this simple thought, code talkers. Code talkers. In Acts 2, in verse 1, listen, I'm all beat up. My back hurts from those trampolines. My thumb is messed up. Brother Joe's thumb is messed up from riding a bull. I've lost my voice. I'm tired, but I'm ready to leave it all on the field. I'm going to leave just completely drained to the things of God tonight. We're going to have some church as long as you'll get involved, as long as you'll worship. As I preach, I won't be very long because my voice won't allow me to be very long, but we're going to do it. Acts 2 and verse 1. We love this scripture. Right? And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. We're in one accord. We're here to worship God. We're in one place. And suddenly, it didn't take a long time. It didn't take a slow progression. Just suddenly, there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as fire that sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. Everybody say, "Oh." Men, women, children, old, young, black, white, purple, gray, orange, whatever it was, all filled with the Holy Ghost. But then it says, and began to speak with other tongues. You see, there's more than just being filled with the Holy Ghost and saying, I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. Began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. If you would just one more time give God a high praise. Give Him the greatest worship you can give Him.
Direct into your life, but they really didn't know what they were saying, but you knew what they were saying. first sermon that Peter preaches in Acts 2:14. Thank you for quoting that. But Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, ye men of Judea and all that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you and hearken to my words. For these are not drunk, as ye suppose, seeing but the third hour of the day. But this which was spoken by the prophet Joel. For the first time, we've seen that manifestation of what Joel talked about. These men are drunk. They're not acting a fool. It's 9 o'clock in the morning. In Acts 2:17, it says, and it shall come to pass in the last day, saith God, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. You see, you need to realize this outpouring of the Spirit that we have experienced in our lives, this outpouring that we hear about all over the world, is a last day prophecy. It's a last day, an end time revival. It's a last day prophecy that the prophet Joel gave, that Peter stood up and gave. In the last day, God is on the power of the Spirit. You see, the last day, Jews, and they're receiving the Holy Ghost. But while Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on them which heard the word, and they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. You see, this Holy Ghost experience is not just for the apostolic church, it's for whosoever will. As I've already said, it's for the black, it's for the white, it's for the Native American, it's for every culture, every color, every creed, it's for whosoever will. It's for the rich, it's for the poor, it's for the educated, it's for the illiterate, it's for everybody. The Holy Ghost and Spirit is for you, it's for me, it's for all that are far off, and many of the Lord our God shall call.
Paul said it like this in 1 Corinthians 13:1, though I speak with tongues of man and of
angels and have not charity.
Hallelujah.
I become a sounding brass.
Yeah.
Indeed.
Hallelujah.
So before we go any further, just step on my notes to clarify.
Hallelujah.
Just because you have the Holy Ghost doesn't make you a Christian.
Praise God.
You need to be a Christian in every aspect, every avenue of your life, everything that you do. You need to be the best employee that your company has. You need to be the best student in your class. You need to be the best at everything. You need to study. You need to educate yourself. You need to do all kinds of things. You need to serve people. So just because you're the Holy Ghost, it's not a catch-all that says, now I'm a Christian. But we need the Holy Ghost. We need the Holy Ghost. Just as baptism, we believe baptism is essential. The Bible says in John 3:5 that you must be born of the water and of the Spirit, for you cannot even see the kingdom of heaven. See, there's more to it than just this head thing that says, hey, I'm going to be baptized. You need to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And how do we receive the gift of the Holy Ghost? With the evidence of speaking in other tongues. In Acts 2, they ask, what must we do to be saved? Peter stands up and repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. It's not a matter of do I need it or how do I get it, but it's a question of when is God going to fill me? How about tonight? What a time to be filled with the Spirit of God. Why would you leave this place without having the Holy Ghost and God is living inside of you? Receive the Holy Ghost and spoke in tongues. Why would I want that?
Right.
She said, well, does it say? I said, yeah, but it doesn't say that I have to see people healed, but I want to see it. It doesn't say that I have to see people raised from the dead, but I want to see it because I want everything that Jesus Christ has for me. I don't want any questions in my mind. If somebody else is getting it, then I want it. If somebody else is experiencing it, then I want it. The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians 14 and 2, for he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto man, but unto God. For no man understandeth him, howbeit in the Spirit he speaketh mysteries. In Isaiah 28:11, for with stammering lips and another tongue will he speak to his people.
Yep.
In 1940, during World War II, the Americans were having a really hard time dealing with the Japanese. What had happened was the Japanese came to the U.S. and got very educated and learned English to the point that you wouldn't even tell that they're Japanese anymore. In every battle that they seemed to win, when they would begin to send out code across the airways, the Japanese would be able to decipher what was going on. But when Chester Nez passed away on June 14, 2012, at the age of 93, it marked the end of an era. Nez was the last living member of the first group of what they called Navajo Code Talkers. You probably know this story, don't you? A group of Native Americans recruited in the United States Marine Corps as a secret weapon to help win World War II. The Code Talkers were not weapons of combat soldiers in the conventional sense. Instead, they were brought into the military for something singular. Only they possessed their native tongue. The Navajo language became the central component for code that provided that was unbreakable for decades. According to the official Naval History and Heritage website, the idea for using Navajo language originated with a civil engineer named Philip Johnson, who had grown up on the Navajo reservation with missionary father. At the time, Navajo remained an unwritten language. It also possessed extremely complex and no alphabet, making it unintelligible. How many times I say, oh, they're just uneducated. Its test, Johnson provided, that the code was not only unbreakable, Navajo soldiers could encode a message in 20 seconds, and it would take about 30 minutes for a machine to do it. The first 29 Navajo Code Talkers recruiters arrived in May 1942. They quickly created a dictionary and code word with common military terms. For example, the word submarine became iron fish. Each Code Talker was deployed to the Pacific with a unit of Marines. There they transmitted messages and orders about tactics, troop movement, and other orders. The Japanese heard these messages, but they were never able to decode them. Numerous battles were won due to strategic advantage. Tonight, as a child of God, you have a strategic advantage over the enemy of your soul. You see, what does the Holy Ghost do for me? What is the point other than it saves my soul? It's my comforter in John 14. It's our peace in John 14. He's our counselor in John 16. He keeps us from sinning in Romans 8. He's our way maker. He's our strength. He gives us power to witness. He edifies us. He builds us up. He will keep you.
Praise.
The Holy Ghost is a gift from God. It has advantages for me. Church tonight, that we need a revival of tongue-talking people that aren't ashamed, that when the power of God moves, we just begin to allow the Holy Ghost out of your belly for rivers of living water. And you know, we get so ashamed to begin to talk in tongues because who knows what somebody else will say? Who knows if someone will get offended? People will think I'm crazy. People will think I'm out to lunch. People will think I'm nuts. But there's a last day revival. inside. Like Jeremiah said, it's fire shut up in my bones. Paul talks a lot in 1 Corinthians 14, not about speaking in tongues in public and the public setting in the church and speaking so people can interpret and understand what they're saying. But then he says this in verse 4, 1 Corinthians 14. He that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifies himself. So I said this morning, you need to get up every morning and you need to begin to talk in tongues. You need to begin to talk in code to God that nobody else can understand. We need some code talkers in the house that will just let the Holy Ghost arise inside of us. We need a revival of tongue talkers. You receive strength from God when you speak in tongues. You receive help from God when you speak in tongues. You build yourself up when you speak in tongues. Romans 8 and 26 says, likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray as we ought. But the Spirit itself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. The literal translation of infirmities. We're going to stand. I don't even want the music to come. Sometimes we rely on music, so no music. But the literal word for infirmities there, it means feebleness. Your weakness. When you don't know what to pray, the Spirit of God makes intercession for you, for your infirmities, for your weakness, for your down and out. It says, by implication, your moral frailty, your disease, your sickness, your weakness.
Hallelujah!
If the enemy's been attacking you, then something in you needs to rise up and say, I don't know what to do. Speaking that language that God gave you. That language that nobody can decipher.